another sunny Sunday. We've had a lot of sunny Sundays, quite pleased to say. We're up to the fourth Sunday of Lent. The journey towards Jerusalem and Easter continues. And I thank you for choosing to be here this morning when you could be so many other places. This is sacred time, and this is sacred space. I invite you to join with me in our call to worship. The grace of Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
We each have a right to be here, a right not based on our righteousness, but on God's free grace. Oh, we'll give thanks to our God who is good, whose saving love endures forever. Let those who are redeemed by God declare it, rescued from trouble and gathered from many lands. From the east and from the west, from the north and from the south, give thanks to God, who is always good. Voices United 338, ask me what great things I know. Seminary students specifically, but often other university students as well, We're given the day off their colleges to go home in the middle of Lent and have a Sunday weekend with their parents. And on these days, the Lenten restrictions were eased, and you could have those forbidden foods that you've given up for the past 4 weeks. The strongest tradition is something called simnel cake. And if any of you have the old United Church cookbook, Let Us Break Bread Together, you can find a recipe for simnel cake in there. If I'd been really organized this week, I was going to bake one. I wasn't really organized this week, so I don't have one. One of these days, I will make you a simnel cake. But it's got cherries and peel in it, things you wouldn't normally eat during Lent. But as we think about salty or sweet, or heaven forbid, those people that actually combine them both, that horrible popcorn, Chicago popcorn, don't give me a thumbs up. Does it matter? Does it matter whether we like salty or sweet? And this is a biblical question. Paul and Peter got into an argument one time about what you can eat and whether it's considered good or bad. In the end, it isn't about what we eat, but about what we believe and what we say. And we may be salty or we may be sweet, but we are all part of that holy experience of Lent and what it means to be part of the family of God. Thanks. I invite you to join me in just a few minutes of prayer. Holy One, we give thanks for the diversity that is people, for those who like salty, for those who like sweet, or somewhere in between. We give thanks that we do not all have to eat or be the same, and that in our diversity we reflect your divine experience. Walk with us this day and all days. We have music again. Voices United 147. What wondrous love. Presence all around us, and that we may know your will for our lives. Amen.
You were dead to the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, followed the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love in which he loved us, even when we were dead to our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Jesus Christ, so that in the ages to come he might know the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Jesus Christ. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not the result of works, but that no one must boast, that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, for God, which God prepared beforehand to be our way in life. And our second reading is from John 3, verses 14 to 21. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only God, Son of God. And this is a judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Here is today's reading.
These are words that come to us echoing through generations. They take root and blossom when we open our hearts to hear that wisdom. So we can't sing right now, so the choir that we might normally have singing John Stainer's God So Loved the World is off the book. They got out of it this year, but perhaps next year I'll look forward to hearing that. I really like that. Touchdown!
Yay!
John 3:16. Goal.
Yay!
John 3:16. Basket.
Yay!
None of you were sports fans. Oh, finally, you get a few arms up in there. I'm not sure what it is about sports games that bring out the evangelist in people. Especially in American games, there always seems to be holding up that sign, John 3:16, by someone. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Something like that. Now, I've yet to see anyone hold that up at a curling game. I've yet to see anyone hold it up at the opera. Or the symphony. And you know what? You'd think it'd be a perfect sign for the end of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. John 3:16. Nevertheless, although we don't hold it up in curling or opera or symphony, it probably is still one of the most recognizable pieces of scripture we have from our New Testament. Almost everyone knows that John 3:16 passage. But I have to say, I'm always somewhat skeptical of that kind of evangelism. This is an evangelism by a pericope, and a pericope is a piece of scripture lifted from its context and setting. It reminds me of the ancient Indian story of three blind folks who are asked to describe an animal that was in the room with them. One offered that it might be a snake. The second offered that no, it must be a fact. And the third, of course, was sure it was not an animal at all, but in fact a tree. And most of you know this story. The mysterious object was, of course, an elephant, based on the trunk, the ears, and the leg. When one does not have a perspective on what is before one, it's hard to get the correct outcome. John 3:16 is one snapshot of John. But John opens with almost as equally a famous set of verses. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It's actually quite a different kind of snapshot than John 3:16. It's much more theological in its vision and speaks of a kind of creation mythology rather than a salvation mythology. And even just a little earlier in the same verse as John 3:16 is one of my favorite verses in the whole Bible. And it's different yet again from either of those two. John 3:8 says, "The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know from where it comes or from where it will go. So it is with everyone born in the Spirit." In this passage, wind is another word for Spirit, and it implies we cannot contain the breath of God. In that sense, it is almost the opposite of John 3:16 in that it understands a broad rather than a narrow path to the Holy. And these are different snapshots only from within one book, the book of John, in the New Testament. Things get much more complicated when we start comparing books like the first three Gospels. We're working between the Old and the New Testaments. I am someone who has always loved art more than my ability to make art. I'm not a great artist. And while I have my grandmother's art box, and it's a cherished possession of mine, there are only three pieces of visual art that I have made with which I am satisfied. But I love the experience of art and what it can do. One of my favorite artists is Georges Seurat, who defined a new form of impressionism in France in the late 1800s. The art that he did was called pointillism. It involved placing very small points of color that only blended at a distance. It might be points of yellow and blue done side by side, but across the room you see as green. It is laboriously slow, but I think the results are luminous. His most famous painting is probably Sunday Afternoon on the island of La Grande Jatte, currently at Chicago Art. In the last year of his life, he produced all of four canvases, and he died far too young, at 31. Often the Bible is the same as pointillism. We can look very closely at individual snippets of stories and see them as a particular color, but we may miss the intention of what that color does until we stand back and take a look at the larger meaning of the book or of the Bible as a whole. This is especially important as we continue the march towards Jerusalem and the Good Friday and Easter experiences. We cannot allow ourselves to get lost in the overwhelmingly devastating reality of Good Friday, because we know Easter is coming. The story of Good Friday is important, but we are always reading it, not for the first time. We know how the story ends. There was only one first time for the story, and it was the experience of Jesus in that moment, not for us. The common language for this problem of pulling small pieces of scripture and using them out of context is proof texting. It's been with us a long time, and it's probably more common among preachers than anyone else. We're always looking for a particular lens for a Sunday morning sermon, and a short, pithy piece of scripture can make us look really smart. smart. Part of the problem is paradoxical. The emergence of the internet and Google means that while fewer and fewer people have actual theological training, information is readily available if you want to go and look it up on Google. If I stand here and preach and proclaim something based on a small piece of scripture, it's not hard for you to go home and check me up to see how I stack up in terms of my interpretation. I have claimed this before and I will stand by it. One of the biggest problems of Christianity is that millennials, the modern generation of young adults, are toxically allergic to hypocrisy. If I proclaim something based on a small piece of scripture and then ignore it the next day, it's no wonder we struggle to attract a new generation of adherents. I realize I should ignore politics, especially south of the border politics, but I'm weak. A couple of years ago, this story hit the news. A pastor closely linked to Donald Trump said he's against sex with adult film stars, but isn't holding the alleged affair with Stormy Daniels against the president. He wrote, "Evangelicals still believe in the commandment, thou shalt not have sex with a porn star. However, whether this president violated that commandment or not is totally irrelevant to our support of him." I'm not going to comment on the actions of that president. My concern here is for those of us in ministry. As soon as we set up one set of rules for one set of people, we aren't going to be taken seriously by the next generation who will be believers. This is especially true in the light of the hashtag MeToo, hashtag Time's Up, and hashtag I Can't Breathe realities. And it's absolutely prescient that this is in the month of women's history that we say these things as well. To ignore a whole set of our congregants and the experiences they've had does no service to the life of the holy. Many years ago, before I was ever involved in theological education leading to ministry, I was a Sunday school teacher. I taught the senior grade at St. John's on the Hill United Church in Cambridge. I never minded dealing with teenagers, while for some reason that wasn't high on the list of most of the other Sunday school teachers. Even 25 years ago, my students could not tell me which books by name were located in the Old Testament or the New Testament. I struggled with that then, but little did I know how much less would be known now versus then. And, I mean, it was one thing with books, you couldn't even ask them how many books were in each testament. That was beyond their capacity. So with biblical literacy in the state in which it is, I encourage caution with John 3:16 or any other single piece of biblical scripture we might want to hold up on its own. At their best, they might encourage people to go and find the Bible and look at the context. But at their worst, they will be a single point of color in the pointillist painting that is the Bible. And that single color will be confused with the entirety of the story. What is this thing called Bible? How are we able to talk about it given the diversity and difference of the stories that it contains? I return to George Seurat. The individual colors are not what make this work. It is the blending of those colors at a distance. We may hold a biblical phrase dear to our hearts. John 3:16, an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But we have to ask, if it holds up against the largest image of the Bible, God is love. Dark colors are always going to be present for contrast, but they will not be the overall image. Even John 3:16 needs to be re-imaged in terms of this larger image, God is love? Do we proclaim a narrow pathway to salvation? Or do we proclaim a broad passage that has been worked for us in love? I will argue for the latter every time. Even from a theological perspective, I would speak of the need of the early church to differentiate itself from the surrounding monotheistic Semitic religions. But when we have limited biblical knowledge, I'm not sure sociological or linguistic arguments mean anything. In a visual culture, I will always return to the art as a way of moving forward and holding all things in love. As we stand back and look at this thing called Bible that has been with us for so long and that has meant so much to so many of us, how do we represent the Bible at its largest picture? God is love. If that is our proclamation, we will score a touchdown every time. Amen. We turn to music once again. This is More Voices 28. God of the Bible.
Thank you.
continue to offer the Northern Bruce Peninsula Cluster weekly Lenten Zoom reflection services on Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. If you're able to participate, please join us. If anyone would like to be down, they are busy. Tie orders are in order, so please place your tie orders. It would be an excellent way to limit your baking requirements for Easter. Immediately after our last hymn, we will be moving into the congregational meeting for this year here at St. Andrews. So the doors will be locked. Please don't leave. And the other thing I just want to highlight, many of you have seen the news already, is the United Church of Canada. We acknowledge the loss of Reverend Jack Tweedle this past week, and in our neighboring congregation, he served at the chalet. So we keep his family in our hearts and prayers as they deal with his loss. Are there other announcements which I have not heard? The collection plate, as always, is on the back pew as we leave the service this morning. Many of you will have contributed by car. Some of you have contributed by grabbing your donations to the church building itself and leaving them there. For all the ways in which you have continued to support the life work ministry of this place, the only words that do justice, thank you and hallelujah. We are mindful that in many places the virus has been used as an excuse for authoritarianism or acts of violence. Pour your spirit out on those who have had to flee or who have been damaged or who no longer have a place to call home. And pour your spirit out upon us, that we may be shoulders for each other to lean on, that we may be a source of strength as others need support, that we may be images of your love in this world. Remind us that in abundance we are called upon to build longer tables and not higher walls. We give thanks for each sunrise and each sunset, each turn of the orbit of our home. Help us to see and listen for this light of this earth, that we may worship in this first cathedral of your creation. And this morning, this week, we celebrate the news from Kenya, where 2020 marked the first time for many years there were no reports of rhino pollution. Into the space. space that lies between us, the space that is your spirit, we offer in silence the weight that lies on our hearts that is only known to you. And we now pray in our voice the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. We turn to music again, Voices United 236. Now thank me, all our God.